Yeah, great public service broadcasting from their album Bright Magic with Andrea Casablanca, and that is called Blue Heaven. Change suggestions. We weren't following on from Stacker Humanoid, but how nice to be able to welcome Pete and Sarah and Bob of St. Etienne. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Let's place you. Pete, are you on the south coast?
Yes, I'm in Hove.
Yeah.
That's where I live.
Sarah, still in Oxfordshire?
I'm in Oxfordshire, very leafy at the moment, all on the ground, autumnal.
Nice. And Bob Bradford?
Yeah.
Bob, you'd be pleased to know that I was talking about the chain. One of the chain suggestions that we played this morning came from one of your compilations. I'm not surprised, because most tracks have been on some of your compilations. But Barbara Lewis, How Can I Tell?
Oh, smashing. Which love that song. Written by Del Shannon.
Was it written by Del Shannon?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, right. I could have used
it. Didn't sound like it, but it was.
Right, okay. A new album I've been trying to tell you, which we'll talk lots more about in the last half hour of the show. Have you been able to work on this together, or has it all been remote?
Remote, yes. We did it a bit like this, across Zoom, although we could see each other.
Yeah.
Bob worked in a studio up in near Bradford, and I was down here in my little studio, in inverted commas, and Sarah was doing vocals at her place with her son being a recording engineer there, and then we'd get together and talk about it and make suggestions and all that.
But how is singing under those circumstances, Sarah? Because I always think that, you know, being a singer in a studio, it's hard not to be slightly self-conscious. Everybody's sitting through the glass watching you. Does it, sitting there with your son in a little studio, does that make it easier or sort of harder, you know, because you're a mum at home and then you've got to be singer?
He kind of left me to it quite a bit. He'd set me up and then I could do things, but every now and then I'd be going, Sam, help! Some weird box has come off on the screen. I don't know what it means, you know. But also, he sings a lot at home, and I can hear him all the time. So if he's not self-conscious, then
right.
I guess I don't feel
good. Yeah. Well, we'll talk lots more about the record, because it's an interesting thing that you've done. But we've asked you to pick some tunes. We're going to have some Bobby Gentry. Who's picked this, then?
I did, actually. Yeah. Although we're all big fans of Bobby Gentry. I'd sort of randomly chose this one because I thought it would sound good on a Saturday morning.
Well,
But we're sort of fans of hers because of, A, she's got an amazing voice, brilliant songs, and her lyrics seem to sort of conjure up amazing sort of filmic kind of vignettes, which is something we sort of try and do ourselves.
Yeah, yeah. Is she still knocking around, Bobby Gentry?
Yeah, yeah, she is, yes. I think she's not been seen in public for a long time. But otherwise, I think she is seen in the supermarket if you live in the town she lives in, but she's very private.
Is she? Right. Okay. Well, let's have a bit of classic Bobby Gentry. This is from 1968, from the album called Local Gentry. I wonder whether they should have landed Gentry. There should be an album, shouldn't there, as well? But this is Sweet Peony.
Houseboat. You should wear your little black rubber raincoat. Write you a letter on a thin line note. Maybe hide it in a tree where the houseboat floats.
Bobby Gentry, interesting, she's still around, very nearly 80. Her last public appearance was in 1982 when she was 40. And since then, she has not recorded, performed or been interviewed for 40 years. That's Bobby Gentry and Sweet Peony, and lots more with St. Etienne in the next half hour.
Six Music.
This is BBC Radio.
Six Music.
Arguing with that, really, is there? Saturday emphatically is Saturday. That's De La Soul. St. Etienne are with us. Any of you ever done any, been keen roller skaters or rollerbladers, Pete?
No, I've tried ice skating and I fell over and cut my leg. No, it was the, there was a nail sticking up or screw or something through the bottom of the skate and it went into my foot.
Yeah.
And I was telling everyone, oh, this really hurts, and no one believed me, and I took it off, there was blood everywhere. So that was,
wow.
That was my experience here, so not everywhere. There was
that's
a
fairly
tiny bit of blood.
That's fairly dramatic. I sort of had a vision of you, Pete, you know, in your skimpy satin shorts, rollerblading down the front at Hove. What about you, Sarah? Were you a teenage roller skater?
Yeah, I was actually. I used to go hunting for cool boys at the ice rink in Richmond, to be absolutely honest.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you find any?
Yeah.
Well done. What about you, Bob? Were you a kind of latent figure skater in your youth?
No, I went to Streatham ice rink a couple of times, but could never let go of the fence around the side.
And no one was going to be impressed by that, were they?
So, no.
I grew up in Bolton and there was a roller rink called the Nevada. That was the only place you could get in if you weren't old enough to go into pubs and clubs. It was the only place, like the fairground, I think, where a lot of us retain a sense of excitement to the fairground. It was the only place you could go and sort of have loud music and flashing lights.
Yeah, it's true.
And we've written a song about fairgrounds. Well, I have anyway.
Yeah, indeed.
It was so alluring. It was amazing.
It really was. It really was, yeah. Anyway, tell us about I've Been Trying to Tell You, which is out now. I mean, who wants to talk about the process? Because obviously lots of things during lockdown, lots of different processes and creative kind of spurts have taken place. But this seems in some way a new record, but also looking back through the archives. Who wants to talk about it first?
It's not especially looking back through the archives. We were thinking about the 90s being a period that a lot of people are sort of looking back to at the moment.
Right.
As an optimistic period. And we were trying to sort of reimagine what the music of the 90s sounds like through 20 plus years.
Okay, I've misunderstood. You weren't going back to things you'd recorded in the 90s. You were going, in a sense, back to things you might have recorded in the 90s with those sounds.
Well, yeah, things other people recorded in the 90s, things you might have heard on the radio. So, I mean, like the samples on the album are, like, quite mainstream. It's like there's Lightning Seeds and the Lighthouse Family, Samantha Mumba. So it's kind of like imagining what the radio sounded like in the 90s, but, like, through this kind of, like, all the sort of fog of memory since then.
Yeah. So
a general idea anyway.
So what did you, how did it start then, Pete? How did the pieces come together? Would you start with a certain sound and the track grew out of that? How would it work?
It was generally, starting with a sample. So we've got this playlist together of tracks that we thought might have bits that would work. And it was pulling them apart, really getting loops, and then there's kind of new software where you can really sort of mess things up and take bass lines out of one bit and mix it with the beats of the other. And so we sort of something would take shape from a loop, really, and then applying lots of mad effects and things. We'd shared things back and forth and going, well, this seems to be taking shape. And they go, I'll try that bit there, or blah, 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 you know, move that bit. Oh, and then Sarah would come up with some lyrics and vocal ideas. But that was all quite loose as well. She'd record a load of stuff and send them over, and we could sort of pick and choose and move things around and treat them almost like samples too.
Well, Sarah, the vocals sort of, in some ways, do a different job to on a lot of St. Etienne records, don't they, in some of these tracks?
Yeah, I wanted them to be just kind of part of the music. I didn't want a sort of lyrical storyline narrative, like a proper song. I wanted it to be like part of the music. So it was really good fun. It was really sort of quite liberating not having to do a song structure. And to just, like Pete said, throw a load of ideas out and then let him or Gus Bousfield, kind of take the things and do what they wanted with them.
Yeah.
Love that. Great.
Well, we'll talk about Gus and the rest of the process and the film and everything. But for people who haven't heard it, let's give them a chance to hear something, and then they know what we're talking about. Fill us in on the starting point for Pond House, then, Bob.
Pond House was Nasty and Bruglia sample.
She's got a new record out. I heard her on the radio the other day. Yeah.
Crazy coincidence. Yeah, she's been very nice about this. It's she's talking about it on Twitter. And yes, one that Gus did in Bradford, it's lovely. I love what he did with it, and
okay. So here's Pond House, and then we'll talk more. Etienne and Pond House from I've Been Trying to Tell You, the new album, which we'll play for John. He said, when Saint Etienne are on this morning, feel free to tell them I have faithfully followed their music since I was about 17. I am now a slightly older, middle-aged bloke who has been looking forward to some new material from these Sonic Pop-tastic Wizards for a while now. And so here it is. And the Sonic Pop-tastic Wizards are with us. Can you have a female? Can you have a female wizard, Sarah?
I guess so. I'm not really big on Harry Potter, so I don't know. But
I'm not
I
sure. Anyway, so you mentioned Gus. Is it Gus Bousfield?
Yeah.
Right. So who's he and what's his involvement?
He's in a band called Gurgles. So I think he's played a bit in your show. He's just somebody I met up here who's a multi-instrumentalist. Has got his own studio. Which I kind of need that really. I can't really make music. It'd just be chopsticks all the time. He's got a pretty similar aesthetic to us, I suppose. We get on really well. And he did two tracks on the album and a bunch of other things we've recorded as well.
So what would you do, Sarah, when you were composing vocal lines and things? Is it easy? I mean, when you're sort of doing lyrics and everything, I would have thought the lyrics help you to remember the tunes that you've composed. If it's more freeform than that, is it difficult to retain what you've sung as a pure melody?
Well, we've got some gigs coming up, so who knows? I think melody sticks in your head, you know. I hate that phrase, earworm. Make me feel a bit sick, but anyway. Yeah. But, you know, it's that kind of thing, and especially repetitive tunes. I love that. I love things that just go round and round with not a lot of change. Don't know what that says about me, but there you go.
Well, Brian Eno always said repetition was very interesting. He said repetition is kind of interesting because you're expecting it to change, and then it gets then it gets a bit boring for a while, but then it becomes really interesting if you carry on long enough with it.
So. Yeah, we were definitely experimenting with repetition on this album, but you know, hopefully repetition with variation, you know, rather than just straight up repetition.
Yeah, yeah, and there's a film that goes with it.
Alistair McLennan's film. Yeah.
Right. Tell us about that.
He's primarily a photographer, like a fashion photographer, but I met him a while ago, and he was a fan of ours. And again, we got loads in common. He's from Doncaster originally, and lives in London. So we met to talk about what we might do. We're talking about the A1, because both go up and down the A1 quite a lot.
The Great North Road.
I think that's kind of been done quite a lot. So we sort of started from that point, and then he ended up shooting all over the country, like Port Mirren and Grangemouth in Scotland.
Home of the Cocteaus.
That's right. Yeah. So it's ended up with this like album length film, which you can get. It's a DVD that comes with the CD, so you can if you buy the CD, you can watch it.
Because, yeah, okay. And that was premiered at Sarah. This sounds terribly grand at the BFI South Bank on the 3rd of September. The Films of Saint Etienne.
I know.
Yes.
I mean, how grand does that sound?
Amazing. I know. It was a whole weekend of films. I think someone from the BFI said to me, apparently, we are the band that has been involved with more films than any other band. Now, whether that's true, I don't know. He is from the BFI and he did say it.
Right. Well, he should know them.
He should know.
more films that hardly anyone's seen than any other band.
But let's gloss over that bit. Who cares about that? The title is interesting. I kind of keep looking at it and thinking, well, what are you trying to tell us? You know, it's an interesting title for this collection of tracks, Pete. Does it have any special significance?
Well, the way I guess we probably all think of it in different ways. I mean, I think of it as the sort of looking back into the murky depths of your memories, and, you know, seeing if there was any kind of signals about what was about to happen.
Right.
in a gloomy sort of way.
is it similarly gloomy for you, Sarah?
For me, it's more cinematic in my mind, kind of like conversational. Anyway, we've all got... it was actually Bob's idea, wasn't it, Bob?
Right, Bob, what does it mean to you then?
Pretty much what Pete said. I think it's kind of like, from the present perspective, looking back to the 90s and being able to, like, see things more clearly. Sort of just reaching out, but, like, not being able to, because obviously you can't reach out to the past.
Yeah,
that's a bit pretentious, isn't it? Sorry.
why not? So you're on tour in November, which it sounds amazing, isn't it, to be able to say to people, so you're on tour, starting at Glasgow, right. St Luke's. Loz and I went there. We went to see the Lemon Twigs there. We were really good. And so how much of this are you going to play? And will you play it with the film?
Yes, some of it will be with clips of the film. We're not going to do the whole album. Mm. Because I think it'll probably be a bit more of a, hopefully a bit more of a party spirit than the general feel of the album. But, I mean, it's something we might do in the future, I think, because the film do go really well together, I think. So it'd be nice to be able to perform it with the film.
Yeah, OK. So Glasgow, Sunderland, Ali Pally, Bristol, Birmingham, Saltaire, Victoria Hall, Liverpool, Grand Central Hall. If I've got all the dates here, it finishes up on the 27th of November. Hometown gig for you, Pete, at Hovell Market.
Yeah, it's a mixture of trepidation and excitement.
I always think the hardest audience to play in front of is people who know you.
Yes, yeah. if they don't turn up, then it's like...
Well, there you go. Yeah. Okay, we're going to finish off by playing Fontaine. Many people will hear that and assume it's about Margot.
Could be, or Joan.
Right. Do you want to say anything about it, or should we just leave it mysterious and play it?
Well, it was originally a 9-minute long, and we spent quite a long time working on this one to get it hopefully just right.
Okay.
And it had verses and things that we removed and all sorts. But, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Lovely to talk to you all. Thank you very much for coming on.
Thanks for having us.
Okay, and we'll see you out on the road in November. And so, enjoy your weekend. And this is St Etienne and Fontaine. Fontaine, St Etienne, from the new album I've Been Trying to Tell You. Thank you very much to Bob, Sarah and Pete for joining us this morning. As I say, tour coming up in November.
Six Music. Starting the day with beautiful music, big ideas and excellent people.
The Six Music Breakfast Show.
All sorts of treats for your ears. Things that we unearth, things that we understand and love that other people might overlook, but we totally get it.
With Lauren Laverne.
I am down for autumn. Celebrate the coziness. Stand at my back door, sniffing the air, trying to catch the whiff of a bonfire. Just can't get enough of it. There's a lot out there that we can't control, but we can be all over the music. We can give you a great sounding start to your mornings. This is
is Lauren Laverne.
It's going to be okay, don't worry. We got you.
Back on Monday morning from 7.30.
BBC Radio 6 Music.
A firework for Paul, who wants to celebrate the engagement of daughter Lydia and Toby. So, congratulations. We'll see you tomorrow with the first, last and everything from She Drew the Gun. That is, yeah, coming up tomorrow. We'll leave you with Talkie Monster. Goodbye.
Talkie Paul up with a B, yeah, you know she a monster. My new wave, got your babe checking for my concert. I'm a West Coast bite back. More like fella Mitchell Prince.